So then, Joe, today we're going to look at some, not all, of the requirements for GS38.
Yes.
This is embedded in the early health and safety unit that we deliver at level one,
yep.
level two, and in the apprenticeship framework.
Absolutely.
However, we go on later in the course to look at using leads that conform and instruments that conform to GS38 when we're doing
Absolutely.
What?
Absolutely. So when we're looking at our inspection and testing units, if you're on an apprenticeship, and also your fault finding units, because for both of those units, you will be required to carry out safe isolation as part of an assessment.
Yeah.
So knowing the requirements of GS38, that guidance note published by the HSE, is really, really important, whatever part of the course you're currently on.
So then, Joe, we can see how GS38 is going to be really important to us from
yep.
almost the moment we arrive at college
yep.
to the point that we exit to do, say, AM2 or AM2S.
Absolutely.
So where can I find GS38?
Very simple, it's a free downloadable PDF. If you just go to your browser, type in GS38 PDF, and generally speaking, it's the top link, isn't
yeah,
it? If you click on that, it will take you straight to the PDF document published by the Health and Safety Executive, and you'll be able to scroll through it. It's a document that's 9 pages long, and today we're going to focus on which key bits of information, guys.
So I always say to my learners, and they will be downloaded in that first few weeks, we're looking for the pictures,
yes.
which I think are on pages 4, 5, and 6.
Yeah, that's the key ones. Yeah.
So we're going to need to read the whole document,
mm-hmm.
but focus on the bits that come out in pages 4, 5, and 6.
Yeah.
And we're looking at the requirements for both the test leads
yep.
and the test probes
yep.
yeah, themselves. So
yep,
there'll be
absolutely.
Some key information in there, and that can be asked at very basic health and safety exams,
yep.
as well as AM2 and AM2S.
Yep.
So in front of us, Joe, we've
yep.
got a couple of different manufacturers of voltage indicators,
yep.
as well as proving units. And
yep.
that's really key as well,
mm-hmm.
that we can actually pre-check our voltage indicator
yep.
before we use it and after we have used it.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, so that's these things here. So that's a proving unit here.
Yep.
And we've got a proving unit over here. This one's a little bit more tricky because it's magnetic and we've got a metal table. So
yep.
we're gonna have some issues
so
there.
So gently when you put it down,
yeah,
so it doesn't bang.
So let's have a look at the actual voltage indicators themselves.
Yep.
We'll concentrate on the one made by Mega.
Yep.
Okay, so we're gonna have a look at that one.
Yep.
However, we have got another one over here, exactly the same requirements applied.
Yeah. So we've got a few things that we need to think about when we first look at this. We've got, first of all, we've got these extremely long tips on show here, guys.
Okay.
So these very, very long tips. What's the issue with perhaps using those straight onto a potentially live terminal?
Oh, so once the tip itself becomes live,
yep.
the remaining part of the exposed tip will also become live, and there is a chance that we could touch yep. those tips.
Absolutely.
Or perhaps even move that tip onto a side of something that isn't meant
yep.
to be live, maybe that's earthed,
yep.
causing a short circuit and
Absolutely.
Therefore disconnect the circuit, massive explosion, all kinds of issues. We don't want any of those.
So to get around that,
yep.
what does GS38 recommend for our probe tips there?
So as we look through the document, and
mm-hmm.
our learners will, and we're not going to give you all the information because we're going to use some of that in the classroom, so
yep.
you're going to need to read those pages.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's key that the tip length
yep.
doesn't exceed 4 millimetres.
Mm-hmm.
And I can clearly see here
yep.
that that's way over 4 millimetres.
It is way over 4 millimetres, yeah.
Another
couple of options that are available. Again, you'll find that in GS38. But here we're going to comply with the 4 mil maximum and
yep.
the 2 mil recommended.
Okay, yep.
Very simply by putting on these caps that have been provided with the piece of equipment. And when we put that on there and screw that on, you can see that actually we end up with only just the very, very tip of that probe showing. And therefore we now know that if we were to put that onto a live terminal, we've only got a very, very small amount of conductive material sticking out of the end there, and that is very, very safe.
So as I look down at that, I can clearly see that isn't at the maximum,
yep.
4 millimetres,
yep.
and it's probably under the preferred 2,
yep.
so
Absolutely.
We've got a very small tip exposure there,
yep.
so when we probe on, we haven't got any issues that we discussed previously.
Absolutely, and if you watch some of our other videos on safe isolation, you'll see one or two recommendations about making sure you've made a good contact with the potentially live part and not accidentally missed it.
And also there's an order in which we should probe on, depending
yep.
on whether we're looking at maybe a line, a neutral, or a protective conductor.
Absolutely.
So that's in some of our other video presentations that we've done.
Yep.
So Joe, that's key for us,
yep.
and our learners will be asked many questions on this. So maximum 4,
yep.
preferably 2.
Yep.
There is another one though. So as you read through the document, you'll see another one.
Yep.
Or sprung loaded.
Oh, okay.
So as we look at these here, Joe, on this different make, we can't see any tip at all.
Nope, so there's no exposed metal on the end there whatsoever.
As you push it against the actual surface itself, it'll
yep.
expose the tip. That's
yep.
obviously way too much.
Yep.
But if I can do the following, you
yes.
can hear the contact, can you?
Very good.
Yeah, so that is actually with contact and we can see no part of exposed metalwork.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got couple of key bits there. Maximum four.
Yep.
Preferably two.
Yep.
Perhaps preferably sprung loaded.
Absolutely.
Or an alternative being sprung loaded.
Yeah. And just to make the point, it would not be acceptable to try and probe onto a terminal by pulling that back, because another part of GS38 also speaks about having finger guards and barriers in place on your piece of equipment. So you should not have your fingers anywhere near that tip pulling that back to access a live terminal. You simply, as you quite rightly demonstrated, push that on,
yeah,
and it will make contact and your fingers remain behind that safety barrier, so you can't accidentally slip and touch a live part.
Yeah, it's really good. So there's another point then, isn't it? As you read through the document, it will say, talk about guards or finger barriers. It'll also talk about shaping of probes.
Yep.
So again, to prevent slippage, that we've got a shaped probe. So yep, if we look at this one again, we've got a slightly finger guard here, stopping yep us falling forward. Okay, and we've got one here again to stop us falling forward.
Yep.
And it's, so we've got an ergonomically good grip,
yep,
so we don't fall into yep a live electrical enclosure.
Yeah, and again, you can see you've got this slightly rubberized grip as well on this handheld probe here to make sure that you don't slip into potentially live terminal.
So we can already see, Joe, that our learners are going to have to pick up a lot of information in just yep a short space of time in with us a couple of weeks, and we're going to be mm-hmm pinging these questions at them.
Yep.
As we look at both of these, so we go back to the mega one,
yep,
we've got a lead, okay, and how would we describe the material that makes the lead between our two probes?
It's certainly a very durable material, isn't it?
It's a good word, yep, durable.
It's going to make sure that that doesn't wear out, become cracked, damaged, or anything like that. But of course, it is your responsibility not to rely on that being durable. You do need to inspect this before every use to make sure that you've not got any exposed parts sticking out there.
Also, adequate length, and we can now see, but especially with our level one learners, we're adding some words in that aren't familiar necessarily in usual talk, are mm-hmm we? We're talking about durable, yes, adequate length,
yep,
okay. So again, adequate length. So we don't want it really short, so we can hardly get it into yep the terminals or move it between them.
Yep.
And we don't want it so the lead's so long that we're treading on it, yep, or it becomes an issue, trip hazard. So again, of adequate length, made of a durable material. Yeah. We'll also go on and talk about other ways in which we can prove safe isolation, and
yep
whether the leads have to be coloured,
yep,
and whether the leads themselves have to incorporate a fuse
mm-hmm
and a current limiting resistor.
Yep.
But remember, this video is also linking to learning in our classroom
yep
and the document that you've downloaded.
Yep.
So then, Joe, so we've done perhaps all the pre-inspections.
Yep.
We've confirmed our voltage indicator
mm-hmm
conforms to GS38, the
yep
document which we've read. We're starting to understand that document.
Mm-hmm.
But before I go out and use this to prove, and in our case, a circuit is dead,
yep,
because we're not proving circuits are live at this stage,
yep,
especially early on the health and safety units, so we're not doing, say, a recheck supply polarity test, can I just walk out into the electrical installation having done a visual inspection of my tester, maybe
no
even made the lights flash on it, and then use it to prove a circuit is dead?
Absolutely not. What we need to make sure is that we make sure that the kit is actually working. It needs to be doing its job.
Okay.
And so in order to do that, there's a couple of ways you can do it. You can
yep
use a known source.
Yep.
I prefer, much prefer using a proving unit. I think there's issues with using a known source.
Yes.
But I much prefer using a proving unit, such as the one we've got here. This is designed to work in tandem with this.
It is.
And it tests the full range of this piece of equipment, making sure it's working
okay
properly.
So if I just lift that up, maybe yep we can just try and see if we can show
absolutely
this to the camera.
So if I put these probes in here, into the two holes, and just press down, you can see there that we get all the lights on both the voltage indicator and also on the proving unit.
Okay.
So we know that both are working correctly.
Yep.
And then we know that this is safe to check for live on the circuit we're trying to isolate.
And we're not looking just to hear that noise.
No.
Okay, we're actually
looking
at the screen, seeing it fully illuminate,
etc.,
and likewise on the actual proving unit itself.
Yep.
And then we're probably happy to go out into the installation, work safely.
Yep.
Okay, and that's something that will be done at college under controlled conditions.
Very much so. And of course, once you've been out and you've proved that your circuit is dead, Gary, can you then start work and just forget about this, or what do we need to do next?
There's a load of other requirements.
Yep.
We're going to talk about this actually in the classroom mm-hmm about securing
yep
the isolation
yep
okay process.
Yep.
But then we've got to come back, haven't mm-hmm we? We've proved the circuit's dead,
yep,
but we've got a final check again. We need to go back to the
yep
proving unit.
There is a possibility that your voltage indicator could have stopped working in between testing and checking for live. It might have broken and
yep
you go, oh, that's great, it's dead.
Yep.
But actually, the circuit's live and this is broken.
Okay.
So you kind of do, I always call it a sandwich, a testing sandwich. You then plug the probes in and make sure that it's still working. So you know, if you get nothing when you connect onto your circuit, you know by coming back
yep
and testing that, you know that that circuit is dead.
So there's a lot of information for our learners to take in, and we haven't give all the information
no
out because we want people to be working through the document,
yep,
which is GS38.
Yep.
So let's just summarise a few of the key points.
Yep.
Maximum tip.
is 4 millimeters long.
Preferably two.
Yep.
And then there's another preferably Joe.
Yep, we also like it to be spring loaded as well as another option.
Yeah, another option to be spring loaded. We know that the leads themselves need to be made of a material, and we use the word
durable, to make sure that it doesn't get easily damaged in use.
Of adequate length.
Yep.
And then there's some processes to go through. Yep. We've got to use this bit of kit here, which is called a
proving unit.
Yep. So we're going to prove our tester before using it.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to test the circuit is live.
Yep.
Are we going to test it's live?
We're going to test that it's dead.
Ah, that's key.
We're test that it's dead.
We're going to prove a circuit is dead.
Yeah.
And we might, first of all, see that the circuit is dead by physically seeing things go off.
Yeah.
So that'll be something that we'll talk about actually in the classroom and the workshop. Mm-hmm. And when we've proved it's dead, what do we do then?
We then go back and we retest our voltage indicator to make sure it's still working after locking off all of the relevant isolators, circuit breakers, or whatever it is that we're isolating with.
So this video introduces GS38, it introduces the voltage indicator and the proving unit, and we're going to go on and look at locking off and making a circuit dead and proving it is dead as well.
Yep.
All of those things will come in the classroom. There are some other videos on GSH that also prove safe isolation and recheck supply polarity. So I think we're ready.
We're there.
We're there.
We hope this video has been some help.